In this screencast, we're going to take a look at an example of sensible heat and use physical property data to help us perform sensible heat calculations. For example, in this case, we want to calculate the heat that's required to increase the temperature of 100 moles of water vapor per second from 100 C to 300 C at atmospheric pressure. So that's shown in the flowchart below, and the heat that's added to the system is raising the temperature from the inlet to the outlet while keeping the phase and the pressure constant. So anytime that we have heat added to the system that elicits a change in temperature, it's called sensible heat. So sensible heat does not refer to a specific type of energy. It simply means that when we're adding heat to the system, we have a change in temperature. If we want to calculate the magnitude of the sensible heat in this case, we can start with the appropriate form of the energy balance. So for an open system, the energy balance reduces to Q is equal to delta H. This assumes that there's no work done by or on the system, and also neglects any change in potential or kinetic energy. The enthalpy leaving and entering the system is extensive. In other words, it's proportional to the amount of material that we're moving through the system. If we want to account for how much water we have, we can rewrite the energy balance as Q is equal to N dot, which is the molar flow rate of water, times the change in specific enthalpy, which is an intensive property. So the units of specific enthalpy are in kilojoules per mole. So if we can calculate the change in specific enthalpy on a per mole basis, we can scale it by how much water we have, which is 100 moles per second, to determine the sensible heat. To visualize how the specific enthalpy of water changes with temperature, we can plot a schematic of H versus T. And for a gas, we would see that the specific enthalpy increases with temperature. However, the temperature dependence is nonlinear. The slope of this nonlinear curve will tell us how the specific enthalpy changes at any specific temperature. Mathematically, we can represent this as the partial derivative of the specific enthalpy with respect to temperature at constant pressure, which we have in this case. This has a physical significance. The change in enthalpy with respect to temperature is the heat capacity. And here we're noting the heat capacity with a subscript of P to indicate that we're at constant pressure. If we look back at the diagram, as we increase the temperature, we can see that we're also increasing the slope of this line, which indicates that the heat capacity is a function of temperature. If we want to calculate a finite change in specific enthalpy over our temperature interval, we can rewrite this expression as a differential equation. So we can write dH is equal to the heat capacity, which is a function of temperature, times dT. And if we integrate this expression from the inlet to the outlet condition, we can obtain a change in specific enthalpy, which is equal to the integral from T in to T out, and we're integrating the heat capacity as a function of temperature with respect to T. To actually solve this integral, we need an expression for the heat capacity that expresses how the heat capacity changes with temperature. Generally, the heat capacity is expressed as a polynomial function of temperature. Specific functions for the heat capacity can be obtained from a variety of different textbooks or chemical engineering handbooks. For example, the expression that I've given below was obtained from Felder and Rousseau in Table B2. And this particular expression applies to an ideal gas. So for an ideal gas, which if we're operating at atmospheric pressure, that assumption is valid, we can write that the heat capacity at constant pressure is equal to A plus BT plus CT squared plus dT cubed. And the units for the heat capacity are in kilojoules per mole degrees C. And A, B, C, and D represent temperature-independent coefficients that are specific to a particular species. So for example, for water, the table below provides a value for A through D, and again, these were also obtained from Appendix B2 in Felder and Rousseau. So with an appropriate polynomial expression for the heat capacity and the coefficients that go with that, we can use this information to calculate the change in specific enthalpy over our temperature interval. So here we're integrating from our temperature at the inlet, which is 100, to the temperature at the outlet, which is 300, and we're integrating the heat capacity function with respect to temperature. If we solve this integral, we will have AT plus b over 2 t squared plus c over 3 t cubed plus d over 4 t to the fourth. And we're evaluating that over our limits of integration, which are 300 and 100. I've substituted in all the coefficients, A through D, as well as the temperature limits. Keep in mind that we're substituting the temperature limits into each temperature term. So for example, we have 300 squared minus 100 squared. We are not squaring the difference between our two temperatures. And that leads to the following four terms if we treat them each independently. And if we look at these four terms independently, we see that the majority of the change in enthalpy is derived from the first term. So often the change in enthalpy, or the heat capacity, is assumed to be constant, and this demonstrates that the assumption of a constant heat capacity will get us pretty close. The higher order terms with the B coefficient and C and D respectively kind of fine-tune that first term. So if we combine all four of our terms, we find that the change in specific enthalpy is equal to 7.03 kilojoules per mole. So we are one step removed from finding out the sensible heat. If we go back to our energy balance, we showed that Q is equal to N dot times the change in specific enthalpy on a per mole basis. So we have 100 moles per second times our change in specific enthalpy, which gives us a sensible heat of 703 kilojoules per second. So we've shown an example of sensible heat and a source of physical property that allows us to calculate a sensible heat. If we can calculate the change in specific enthalpy using heat capacity functions, we can scale it by the material that we have and calculate the heat associated with that process.